Hello, everyone. My name is Henry, and I'm the treasurer for The Spectator and the president of College Republicans.
And my name is Haley. I am vice president of College Republicans. We are excited to greet you all today in Lee Chapel for a very special event. Before we begin, please locate the nearest exit in case of an emergency. In addition to the door that you entered through, there are three exits in the basement at the bottom of the stairwell located behind me to the right. Thank you. Before we start, I want to say thank you to Young America's Foundation, the Dr. Jefferson Futch III Speaker Forum, and the Generals Redoubt for their generous support and assistance with this event. I also want to thank the university for upholding First Amendment principles. Free speech is increasingly under attack on campuses across the nation. Alternative viewpoints on many important issues are condemned as harmful or even violent. Accordingly, The Spectator and College Republicans find it essential to invite speakers who represent increasingly targeted conservative values in a forum where both sides can engage in dialogue. We wanted a speaker who is bold, courageous, and is proven to affect real change. In other words, a true leader in the conservative movement. We wanted a speaker who would present conservative ideals foundational to College Republicans, as well as the journalistic spirit of The Spectator.
Matt Walsh is one of the most visible and prominent voices in the young conservative movement and a lead columnist for the Daily Wire. He is the author of four books and the host of the hit podcast, The Matt Walsh Show. He continues to make waves with his hit film, What is a Woman?, in which he interrogates contemporary gender ideology. The film's examination of transgenderism remains timely as debates over gender ideology disrupt politics across the country. After months of hard work and late nights, despite a petition to ban our event, posters being torn down, Eventbrite deplatforming our ticketing page, threats made nationally against our speaker sufficient to postpone the event, and push back every step of the way, we are finally here today to present Matt Walsh.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. Thank you. I always say, please don't applaud too much before I start speaking, because then I can only disappoint you. So you set the bar too high. I do appreciate the intro as a young conservative, so I'm still holding it. I'm just barely holding on to that title at the age of 37, so I'm gonna keep it for as long as I can. All right, well, just to jump right into it, as you probably know, I have been speaking out against the suicide cult known as transgenderism for years now. Like, just jump right in. I don't, you know. I don't need to warm up. It's just, let's do this. And that means that for years, though especially over the last year and a half, I've been accused of directly killing trans people, of murdering them, committing a genocide against them, just with my words alone, somehow. Now, anybody who criticizes trans ideology will be accused this way. Anyone who opposes the trans agenda is automatically genocidal, according to the gender ideologues. By failing to affirm transgenderism, by standing in its way, by disagreeing with it, we are engaging in a form of, you know, mass murder. We're getting people killed. We're Nazis committing a Holocaust against the trans community, they say. I think it's worth thinking about what exactly is meant by this when we hear this. It's easy enough to dismiss it as hysterical nonsense, which it is, but what is meant by it? It's, of course, a reckless and intentional lie, but what else is going on here? Well, we know the genocide claims cannot refer to any kind of physical threat, because trans people face no such threat. Now, sure, towards the end of each year, you'll see reports in the media about all the trans people who were murdered during that span, and this will be accompanied by denunciations of hate and transphobia. But what they won't tell you is that nearly all of those murders were related to domestic disputes or drugs or prostitution. So the propagandists will tally up every single trans person who was the victim of a homicide in a given year and imply that all of them, every single one without exception, was a hate crime, as if it's impossible for a trans person to be killed for any other reason. These are the games that the media plays. Now, this is nonsense, obviously. The question is, How many trans people murdered in a single year are murdered because they are trans? You know, how many actual hate crimes of the total amount are there? Well, for the most recent year on record, which is 2021, the FBI has a number for that. And here is the number. When the media talks about the trans genocide, the trans hate crime epidemic, here's the total number of people in 2021 who were killed, the FBI says, for being trans. And that number is 2. So 2 trans people in the entire country in an entire year were killed in what the FBI considers a hate crime. So this is the epidemic that you hear about, 2 people. Now, just by comparison's sake, the trans terrorist at Covenant murdered 3 times as many Christians in a single attack. Now, to put this in perspective, a recent USA Today report claims that about 1.6% of the US population, the adult population, identifies as trans or non-binary, which works out to about 4.1 million people. And that means that 0.00004% of that population was murdered in a hate crime. Now, overall, the FBI recorded 271 hate crimes against trans people. This includes things like harassment, intimidation, people saying mean words they don't like, all the rest of it. So taking all the crimes into account, that's 0.006% of the trans and non-binary population that were victims. Now, to put that in perspective, there were also 1,341 racially motivated hate crimes, according to the FBI, committed against white people, which works out to 0.0006% of the white population, which means that if you are a white trans person, you are nearly as likely to be victimized for being white as for being trans. It's a difference of a tiny fraction of 1%. And that's in spite of the fact that the people in charge of compiling these statistics have a vested interest in vastly undercounting the number of anti-white hate crimes, which they do, and vastly overcounting the anti-trans hate crimes, and they do that also. Despite all of that, despite their best efforts, still we are left with the reality that a vanishingly minuscule number of trans people are victimized in this country. There is no significant outward physical threat against trans people, period. So again, what do they mean by genocide when we hear about genocides? Well, to answer that, we must consider the fact that we live in the age of the psychological man. And what this means is that in our era, we define ourselves by our psychological state. So the individual sees himself, sees his selfhood as an amalgamation of his beliefs, his perceptions, his feelings, his desires. In other words, myself is how I feel about myself. Whatever I feel about myself, well, that's what myself is. My feelings about myself are myself. Now, nobody on the left has ever been able to define the word woman or explain what a man means when he says he identifies as one, but this is the answer, the one that none of them can actually give because they don't understand their own worldview enough to give it. A man is a woman if he feels like one because we are our feelings. That's what they believe. My inner self-perception determines myself. I don't need to bring my self-perception into alignment with my physical self, rather I bring my physical self into alignment with my self-perception. Now, all of this is, of course, fundamentally incoherent and rife with contradictions and paradoxes and impossibilities, but this is how the leftist mind works. Indeed, it's how the modern mind works in general. Even those of us who reject transgenderism still share some of the underlying psychological scaffolding that the ideology rests upon. I think this is one of the reasons why American society, even people who disagree with this ideology, have been to this point not very effective in opposing it. And the reason is that they share a lot of the mistaken underlying assumptions, but they don't even realize it. You know, we all tend to place a premium on our feelings. Many of us fundamentally and mistakenly believe that the very point of life, the only point really, is to conjure good feelings within ourselves and to hang on to those feelings no matter what it takes. This is a very modern, very Western attitude, and it needed to be established before transgenderism could gain a foothold. Now, how does this relate to the genocide claims? Because if my self-perception is myself, if my feelings about myself are what determine and define my selfhood, then when you fail to affirm my feelings, when you call those feelings into question, when you cause me to question them, then you are in effect killing me. By making me feel bad, you are assaulting my emotions, my inner peace, my inner perception. And that is worse than assaulting me physically, because my feelings are more important than my body. This again is the way leftism works, and it pertains not just to transgender, but every single issue. Misgendering a trans person becomes a genocidal act, no different from rounding them up and throwing them into concentration camps. You may not be injuring their bodies, but you're injuring their self-perception. You are hurting their feelings. It is a holocaust of hurt feelings. And that is just as bad as the regular holocaust they believe. Now, that's not to say that trans people face no significant physical threats. They do. It's just that the threat comes from themselves. As they say in the horror movies, the call is coming from inside the house. The statistics clearly show that if a trans person is going to be killed by anyone, the culprit will almost certainly be himself. Now, the majority of trans people who are killed each year are killed by suicide, and there are a lot of suicides. This is the other meaning, the second connotation behind the genocide claim. If you disagree with them, if you fail to affirm them, they might kill themselves in response. So trans activists are holding guns to their own heads and telling you to back down or they'll pull the trigger. They engage in the most grotesque form of emotional blackmail imaginable, using suicide as a bargaining chip, and it has been a very effective strategy. This is the genocide. When they use that term, what they really mean is, if you hurt my feelings, I will kill myself, and it'll be your fault, because you said the words. And this, again, has proven to be a very effective tactic. Many people who are well-intentioned, good people, they don't want to hurt someone, they don't want to be responsible for a suicide. They hear that and they say, okay, well, then I'll stop talking. Now, the appropriate response to these kinds of perverse ransom demands is not to stop talking. It's to say this: no, your feelings are not my responsibility. It is not my job to prop up your self-perception. It's not my job. You cannot assign me to the task of making you feel good about yourself. That is not my job. That's not what I was put on this earth to do. I have a job, and it's not that. And although I very much hope that you do not hurt yourself, if you do, it will not be my fault. You will not threaten me like that. You will not manipulate me into silence. Your actions are the results of your own choices. I cannot control them. You are not my puppet. You are your own person. But if you're looking for something external to blame, then you can blame trans ideology itself. So if we're expanding the concept of genocide, then we must conclude that transgenderism itself is genocidal. The ideology itself is genocidal, and not just because it drives radicals like the Covenant Shooter to commit mass murder against Christians. The ideology is genocidal because of what it does to those who are brainwashed into it. Now, it's true that the rate of attempted suicide among trans people is extraordinarily high. Trans activists will claim that it's something like 40%. Now, the evidence for that figure, for the 40% figure, is rather spotty at best. But there does seem to be evidence enough to conclude that the rate, whatever it is exactly, is significantly higher than the general population, much higher. Meanwhile, the rate of suicidal ideation, the number of trans people who consider suicide, is well above 50%, according to most studies on this. 50%. So there seems to be wide agreement that trans-identified people are much, much more likely to consider suicide and to attempt suicide than non-trans people. The activists have their own explanation for this, of course. They claim that trans people attempt suicide at such a staggering rate because they are bullied and rejected by society, by people like me and many of you. But this explanation doesn't hold water. If the suicide rate was linked to societal rejection, then we should find that it drops down much closer to levels commensurate with the general population as society becomes more affirming. So we should see affirming rates go up, suicide rates go down, if the suicide rate is indeed tied to a lack of affirmation. But that is not what we see. Suicidality among trans-identified people remains sky high, even as society, by any objective measure, becomes far more accepting of trans-identified people than it ever has been before. In fact, the problem for this line of thinking runs even deeper, because prior to the mid-20th century, There was no acceptance of transgenderism at all, anywhere. For most of human history, a man who claimed to be a woman would have been laughed at, ridiculed, rejected, ostracized, locked in an institution as an insane person for most of human history. Now, if, as the left claims, the increase in trans identification is not the result of social contagion, which it is, but they say it's not, they say, well, it's, we have more people identifying as trans now than were in the 1930s, but that's not because of social contagion, it's just because people are, you know, trans people have always existed, but now they feel more able to live that truth openly. Well, if that's the case, and if a lack of affirmation causes suicide, then that should mean that for thousands and thousands of years, trans people were killing themselves at a staggering rate. I mean, we should be able to go back through history and find just thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people mysteriously killing themselves because they thought that they were the wrong sex, trapped in the wrong body. But nothing like this happened in history. There's no recorded evidence of it at all. Now, we do, on the other hand, have examples of actually persecuted and oppressed groups, groups that faced enslavement, literal physical genocide. And we can look through history at groups like that, and we can look and see, well, what happened with their suicide rate? I mean, groups that actually faced persecution. Well, none of them had a suicidality rate of 50% or more. Even the victims of Nazi concentration camps, according to most figures, had a suicide rate of 25%. Still well below the reported trans rate. And those were people killing themselves as a means of escaping starvation and torture. So let me ask you this, is the life of a trans person in modern America more difficult than a Jew in the Holocaust or an African slave in the 1840s? Would anyone like to step up to the plate and defend that proposition? Of course not. So why is the suicide rate so much higher for trans-identified people? Now, far from having it difficult, in fact, trans people in modern America are among the most privileged human beings who have ever walked the earth. They are relentlessly celebrated by all of our major institutions. They are affirmed, they are applauded, they are practically worshipped. Every major corporation, every government agency, Hollywood, academia, the media, all dedicated to affirming these people. Laws are rewritten to accommodate their mistaken self-perception. Society is restructured on their behalf. The dictionary is edited to include them. They are followed around by a cheering parade and a marching band with trans flags waving proudly in the wind. And yet they are still in a state of self-destructive, suicidal despair. To explain that, perhaps we should consider another possibility. Maybe it's time to wonder whether there might be something deeper going on. If you desperately need this much affirmation all the time, and it still isn't enough. You know, if you are sent into convulsions of panicked rage because even one person amid a fawning crowd fails to applaud you, it might be because there is something seriously wrong within yourself. It might be time to think about that. And I know what it is. Trans ideology is self-destructive at its core. That's why I've dedicated so much of my life to combating it. It is, in effect, a suicide cult. It breeds despair and hopelessness. It puts a person into conflict with his own inherent biological nature. To be trans, to fall victim to trans ideology, is to get sucked into the cult. It's to be at war with yourself, perpetually in a state of violent self-rejection. As we discovered while making my film, What is a Woman?, trans-identified people cannot speak coherently about their own identities. Now, they like to speak about their identities. It's often the only thing that they want to talk about, but they can't say anything cogent or intelligible about it. I mean, I've done this. You could sit down and talk to them. Well, tell me about who you are. They'll say a lot of words, but none of it makes any sense. And that's because trans ideology is confusion. It causes you to call into question your true biological identity. But here's the point. It doesn't replace that identity with anything solid or understandable. And this is the way leftism always operates. We often hear the claim that leftists like to redefine words. They've redefined woman, they've redefined marriage, they've redefined many words, but that's not the right way of phrasing it, because redefine means you get rid of one definition and you come up with a new one. But they don't come up with a new one. They just get rid of the old definition, and then when you ask them, okay, if it's not that anymore, what is it? They stare at you blankly. Or they call you a homophobe or a transphobe. They won't give you the new definition. So this is the confusion. Creating confusion where there was once clarity, darkness where there was once light. And in that darkness grows anxiety, which is the fear of the unknown. Okay, and this is one of the reasons why we live in a culture that is plagued by anxiety. And we'll be told by the pharmaceutical companies that there's so much anxiety because there's a mysterious mental illness going around, and the only way to deal with the anxiety is to take more drugs. But anxiety comes from the unknown. It's about the things you don't know. That's what makes you anxious. You know, you walk down into a dark basement at night and you're anxious because you don't know what's lying in the darkness. Joe Biden stands at the podium. His handlers are very anxious. They don't know what he's going to say. He can say anything at any moment. Well, transgenderism is an anxiety machine. It's a depression factory. It's an ideology perfectly crafted to make people kill themselves. Now, the transgenocide, what we may call a self-genocide, goes beyond this. This ideology drives its adherents to self-destruction. They drink the trans Kool-Aid like the disciples of the People's Temple lining up to dose themselves with cyanide. But not every cult member is there by choice. You know, there were children among the 900 who died at Jonestown, just as there are many children who fall victim to the trans cult today. Children are castrated and sterilized, entire future generations erased in the name of gender affirmation. Children who are convinced to sacrifice parts of themselves that they don't even understand. What does it mean to say to a 14-year-old, well, you're gonna take this and you'll never be able to have kids in the future? And the 14-year-old consents to that? What does that mean? What does the 14-year-old know about what his or her 25-year-old self is going to think about that? You know, it's the 25-year-old self that's going to be childless, wants to have a family and can't, and is going to have to live with the decisions that the 14-year-old self made, because those weren't really decisions made by the 14-year-old self. You know, these are people who are too young to consent, too young to understand what they're doing and what is being done to them. Nevertheless, ushered into a sterile life of suicidal depression, where they'll be unable to have children of their own in the future, unable to grow fully into the sex they were born as, stuck in this eternal limbo state, not fully resembling either their true sex or the one they tried to transition into. If you're looking for genocide, here it is. Yeah, but the left tells us that genocides come in more abstract forms. For them, that means a genocide of feelings. But I would borrow this concept and point to a different form of non-literal genocide inflicted upon the country by trans ideology. And that is a genocide of common sense, a genocide of truth. Now, this is the greatest threat posed by transgenderism, not the physical harm it causes, which is immense, immense. But the even greater crisis is that it destroys our recognition of and ability to understand basic truth. And it's for this reason, first and foremost, it's assault on truth, that I say trans ideology is the most toxic evil our nation faces today and must be burned to the ground. If you are a trans-identified person, then you should be the most on board with this campaign, because trans ideology has taken more from you than it will take from any of us. You are a victim, just not in the way that you think. You are a victim of transgenderism. You have fallen prey to the ideology. And the ideology is wrong, which means that you are wrong. You are wrong about your view of the world, of reality, of yourself. Nobody will tell you this, but it's true. You are deeply, catastrophically wrong. And you are on a path that can only lead to despair. It cannot have any other outcome. There is no joy. The media likes to talk about trans joy. Look at all the trans joy. And they talk about trans joy, and inevitably they show us a picture of some absolutely miserable-looking, mangled mass of flesh. They talk about trans joy, and they show us Ellen Page just looking absolutely horrifically sad all the time. And of course she is. She has chopped off pieces of her own body in an attempt to become something that she can never be. But if you're a trans-identified person, most people won't tell you this, they'll lie to you because they don't care about you. Your life means nothing to them. And the crippling regret that you will feel in the future will not faze these people. You know, you'll come back to these people and you'll say, how could you have gone along with this, mom? How could you have gone along with this, teacher, counselor? Why didn't you tell me the truth? And they won't have an answer for you. They will leave you to wallow in the shattered remnants of your life, of your broken and mutilated body, and they will feel nothing because they're using you and they are deceiving you and they don't care about you. The trans activists who promote this stuff, the ones who push this, who brainwash you, who lead you deeper into this confusion, I mean, they are your enemies most of all. They're the ones you should resent. And so finally, to those trans activists, the ones who are doing most of the ranting about imaginary genocides, I would want to say one thing, and I don't think there are a lot of trans activists in this particular crowd. Maybe there are. I don't see any purple hair at the moment, but if they're watching on the stream, if they see the video. I just want to say one thing, because it's important to understand. You know, we hear so much from the trans activists about, again, the genocide they're suffering and how they're being victimized and bullied by people like me. And, you know, what you should realize is that you started it. So when you're on social media, you're on the news, you're out marching the street, crying your crocodile tears and claiming that you're being set upon by fascist right-wing bigots who won't leave you alone to just live your life in peace. You say, what did we ever do to you? Why are you so angry at us? Well, let me answer that question. You see, the rest of us were living our lives. We were minding our own business. When you came along and demanded that we abandon everything we know about fundamental physical reality for your sake. You claim the right to walk into whatever bathroom you want, whatever locker room you want, whatever sports team. No one else has ever had that right in history. No one else has had the right to just do whatever they want and go anywhere they want. But you wanted that right. You came after our children. You seek to suck them into your suicide cult just to make yourself feel better. You want my children to share in your confusion so that you can feel better. And you wonder why that makes me angry. You tried to restructure human society to make it affirming to you personally. You wanted to force the whole world to bend to your narcissism. You tried to put words in our mouths. You tried to control how we speak, even when we're not in the room with you. You tried to tell us what words we're allowed to use when we talk about you, even if you're 1,000 miles away. It's just this staggering level of narcissism that the world has never seen before. And you came and you just dumped that on society. You tried to take possession of parts of the English language. You waved that hideous flag in our faces, wouldn't stop waving it. You demanded not just tolerance, but celebration. And now you cry victim because some of us have simply said no. And that's all we've said, just no. I know that's all the things you want. I know what your demands are. No, you can't have it. I'm not doing it, I'm sorry. Well, I'm not sorry, but I am saying no. You made demands. Many people surrendered to those demands immediately, but some of us, a few of us, are refusing, and that makes you a victim? You bullied most people into submission, but now you want to cry because a few of us can't be controlled so easily? This, again, is a testament to your boundless narcissism. You know, it didn't have to be this way. If you were really interested in privacy, and this goes for the whole LGBT alphabet soup, if you really just wanted to live your life in peace, you could have done that. You could have done that. You could have had it all. If you had just said, I'm going to live as though I'm the opposite sex, and I'm going to tell everyone I'm the opposite sex, and I'm going to change my name and how I dress, and I'm going to do all this because it's what I want to do and it's how I want to live. Then you could have done it. Now, I personally still would not have agreed with your lifestyle. I would not have gone along with the charade. I would not have affirmed it or participated. But you could have done that, and society generally would have left you alone, as you claim you want. That was already the experience of the very small minority of trans-identified people in this country up until the last decade or so. You know, from the early 20th century to the last decade or so, there were a small, very small number of people who identified as trans, and they just kind of, you know, they were men for the most part. They put on the dress, they walked around, it was a fetish, and they did it, and most people didn't bother, and some people didn't know, people suspected, they're like, look, that looks kind of like a dude, but they didn't say anything, and that's just the way it was. But that wasn't good enough for you. In your vanity, you couldn't be satisfied merely with the ability to live how you want. You demanded celebration. You needed not just the ability to practice your lifestyle, but a parade following you around and cheering for it. And you needed affirmation, this obsessive, unquenchable need for affirmation. Nobody else walks around every day demanding that the entire world affirm them every second, but that's what you wanted. You couldn't just believe whatever you believed about yourself. You wanted the rest of us to believe it too. And in fact, you demanded that the rest of us believe it too. And if we wouldn't believe it, you demanded that we pretend we believe it. And you wanted our children. You wanted to induct countless children into your confusion, baptize them into it, so that your confusion, that the confusion you foster in them, might affirm the confusion you harbor in your own mind. You know, you pretend that you wanted freedom, but you had that. You wanted more, a lot more. You wanted to reshape our entire culture in your image. You didn't just want your own lifestyle, you wanted us to participate in it with you. You know, I read my kids the story of the give a mouse a cookie, one of the most prophetic texts of our time. And you are the mouse who wanted the cookie, and you were given the cookie, and you ate it, but then you wanted to eat everything else in the house too. Some people object, finally object, and you break down in tears like a child who has to leave the playground. You push too far, way too far, and now you're feeling the pushback. In summary, you wanted this fight, you asked for it, you demanded it, and now you have it, whether you like it or not. Thank you. That's all I have.
So we will now be making our Q&A session open. Please state your name and your major, and then keep your questions brief and respectful, please.
Hi, I'm Drew. I'm doing a double major in economics and history. And I was wondering, how do you refute postmodernism philosophically and convince people of an objective reality? Thank you.
You know, this is a conversation that came up in What Is a Woman quite a bit when we were especially walking around. Well, everyone we talked to, in fact, what we found is that it began as a conversation about transgenderism, and quickly devolved into this postmodern "what is truth." You know, all of a sudden you're talking to Pontius Pilate. What is truth? I found obviously it's difficult because when you're talking to someone who has rejected the very concept of truth. And it seems like you have no common ground to share. They've put themselves in an entirely different universe. And in order to convince someone of something, you have to know what your common ground is, and then you have to know what basic values and ideas you share so you can appeal to that in your argument. But if they reject the very concept of truth, then it can be difficult to do. I mean, obviously there are the paradoxes you can point out that I don't think are going to convince anyone in the moment, but over time might, like for example, if there is no truth, then how can you say that there is no truth? You are asserting the truth that there is no truth, which doesn't make any sense. Which is a simple argument. I think the simple ones are the best. It does reveal just, it's not that saying there's no truth is wrong, it is wrong, but it's incoherent. It doesn't even mean anything. It actually is like, it's an incoherence. And I think pointing that out is very important. And then also, I try to ground it as much as possible in, you know, the space where you're currently sitting. So they're, you know, I was talking to somebody, I can't remember if this made it into the film or not, but one person I was talking to on the street when we were doing the Man on the Street interviews, and asked him, you know, what is a woman? We went through all that, and eventually it went into this whole, well, there is no truth, you know, I have my own truth, you have your own truth. We were standing next to a telephone pole, and I said, well, here's a telephone pole. If it's my truth that this telephone pole doesn't exist, can I just walk through it? And she didn't really have an answer to that, and I tried. I said, well, let's see. No, I can't. Which is like, it's silly, but it's just, I think in that case that the simplest arguments like that are going to be the best, and maybe it plants a seed and gives them something to think about in the future.
Thank you very much.
So now we'll be directing our attention to the back of the room in the corner. For those of you who had a question but weren't able to make it to the Q&A line, please get the attention of an usher or raise your hand and they'll make your way over here behind me. So,
are you going to hold it? Okay, cool. I'm going to preface my question by stating that there's currently 5.6 million intersex Americans, which are people who are biologically not considered female or male because they have incorrect chromosomes during their like process of being born. So my question is, why do you personally not support gender-affirming care when a majority of those who are seeking gender-affirming care are intersex individuals, considering that there are double the amount of intersex people that are Americans and adults than there are trans people? And why are you fueling the rights ideology of this like trans panic when considering that this healthcare that isn't even really for trans people, they just happen to use it, is more for other issues? And by doing so, you're limiting people who are suffering to get those actual treatments that they need.
Okay, so let's just go through a couple points here. First of all, you're saying that the so-called gender-affirming care is not for trans people. So what, just for the sake of argument, what if I said, okay, I agree with everything you said, gender-affirming care should be available for intersex people, but not trans. Can we agree on that then?
Yeah, I would agree, but the laws that you're supporting don't. That's well, why that, I'm
that's
asking
actually,
the
that's
question.
Actually not accurate. Have you looked at the legislation?
Yeah, what, I'm current. Oh, can I respond to you really quick?
Well, let me finish asking my question. What specific law would prevent someone with a genetic anomaly or a deformity from seeking some kind of medical care or plastic surgery?
So currently, one of the ways to fix intersex like issues that you find down the line, which is currently typically like infertility for men, erectile dysfunction, when you figure it out when you're around a teenager, you have to start doing hormone therapy and hormone blockers, both of which are banned under multiple, including the one that I'm specifically referencing, in the Kentucky proposed state law, would make sure that intersex individuals would not have access to those, as it's considered under the umbrella of gender-affirming care, because technically it is affirming their gender, as they don't have a strictly male or female like genitals or a reproductive system.
Okay. I have to confess, I'm skeptical of your reading of the Kentucky law. I have not read the exact language of that law myself, so I can't say for sure that you're wrong about that. What I do know is that, what I can speak to is the Tennessee law, for example, where I'm from, which bans these procedures, castration, mutilation, specifically mentions that if someone has an actual valid medical issue, then obviously they don't apply. It's the same thing as, you know, we should ban cosmetic double mastectomies for gender confused women. Obviously, if you have breast cancer, you need a double mastectomy, then you would not be forbidden from getting that. It's very easy to write that language into the law. Now, that's the first thing. Going to your point about intersex, a couple of points here, a couple of things you said that I think aren't true. The first is you said, how many intersex people?
There's currently, the United States clarifies in their census that there is 5.6 million Americans, which is double the amount of trans adults in the United States.
5.6 million. Do you know how, for that figure, to arrive at that figure, do you know how intersex is defined?
Yes, intersex is defined as either having a chromosomal, here I actually have the exact definition pulled up on my phone from the U.S. Census, because I wanted to make sure. It includes people with an extra or missing sex-linked chromosome, those born with other physical variations that don't fit into the categories of male or female. This is seen as someone who has breast, but also has a penis.
Yeah. The issue is that the caveat there about other physical variations. So one thing that you should be aware of is that the actual number of intersex people has been, over the years, drastically inflated. And one thing that they've done is they've included, for example, a male who has an abnormally small penis size, for example, can be included as intersex under current definitions of the term. So what they're doing is they're taking people to sort of inflate the number of intersex people. They're taking people who their biological sex is very clear, but there might be some variances in their body, and then they're saying, well, that's intersex too. And I think the reason that they're doing that is, well, it kind of goes right to this conversation now, that the existence of intersex people is judged as very convenient for trans people in the LGBT movement. It's why they've included intersex in the pride flag, even though by your own accounting, intersex has nothing to do with gay pride, trans, got nothing to do with it. It is a genetic anomaly, it is a physical deformity, it's a defect, it's a disease, whatever words you want to use. That's what it is. It's got nothing to do with any of that. So there is a concerted effort to inflate those numbers because they find them useful. Last point, it's not that intersex people are not their own sex. Okay, you said that they wouldn't count as male or female. That's not correct. There are only males and females in the human species. There is no third sex. No biologist worth his salt would recognize any third human sex. It can't be defined, it can't be named. An intersex person, an intersex individual is a man or a woman whose biological sex, for this small minority of people, is harder to determine because of genetic anomalies that may affect, for example, their sex organs. But they're still male or female. Okay, there are only male or female gametes, ova or sperm. That's all that there are. There are no other options. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. Can I ask a follow-up question really quick then?
Sure.
So
someone said no, but I'm gonna say yes.
Okay. So and you said that it's either male or female. It's just harder in determining what it is. But in this time frame, would you say that there is technically a fluid system of what could be considered male and what could be considered female, such as with real-life examples, people who do have breasts that look like female breasts, but they do have a penis? Would you say that is a man?
There's a very good system for determining if there's a male or female, and it's right almost every time. I mean, it's right 99.9% of the time. It's only for a small minority of genetic anomalies that there's any kind of issue at all. Now, you just gave the example of someone with breasts and a penis. Well, again, you're taking a hypothetical person. I would need an actual individual, and depending on how they look, that shows how deep we sort of have to go to figure out what their actual biological sex is. But I will say that a male who develops breasts is obviously still a male. The last point I'll make about this is that another way of looking at it, there's no third sex, right? And the way that we know that is because there is no category of person who has the reproductive capacities of both male and female. So it's you either have the reproductive capacity of male or you have it of female, or you're supposed to have the reproductive capacities of a male, but you don't because of a disease, or female, but you don't because of a disease. A third sex category, I suppose, would be someone who has both reproductive capacities. If you were to find somebody like that, well, now you have identified a true third sex individual, someone who does not fall under the category of either male or female. That sort of human being has never existed on the planet. and never will exist and can't exist, because there are only males and females. All right, thank you.
Howdy, sir. My name is Patrick Sexton. I'm a first-class cadet from VMI across the street. I study history and get a minor in philosophy. So my question is kind of moving away from the points talked about tonight. With a growing number of young Americans, specifically young men, feeling disenfranchised in today's modern culture, is there any encouragement you can give or perhaps any changes you may see coming that would give young men my age encouragement as they enter the professional workforce, start families, etc.?
It's a great question, and what I would say is, you get questions like this, I try not to devolve into self-help guru cliches, but it's kind of hard to. But the real answer is don't give up and be jaded and discouraged. I mean, it's hard, I know, but I talk to a lot of young men who are in their early 20s and are just kind of getting out into the world as an adult, and they're already just utterly discouraged. They've given up any hope of, for example, finding a good woman and getting married and having kids. You know, I every day I hear from men who are 22, 23 years old and have already given up in this way. And the first thing I would want to say is that you're allowing despair to take root in your soul, which we cannot do. You're looking at the sort of situation in our from a civilizational standpoint, and you're making assumptions ahead of time about what you're going to be able to achieve, and that's always wrong. And the other thing I always like to say to young men in particular, before you get married and before you have kids, is that really the opportunities for you are endless. I mean, this is the case for a lot of people in this room right now. You don't have kids, you're not married, you don't have those kinds of responsibilities yet. Hopefully in the future you will. And so the list of things that you can do is like endless. There's no reason, for example, when you graduate and you're wherever you live and you're looking around, you don't see any jobs that you want. And then you say, well, there are no jobs, I can't find a job. You can go anywhere. I mean, you can go literally anywhere. You know, there's nothing tying you down. You could take all kinds of risks, like big risks. I did this in my early 20s. You take big risks. If it doesn't work out, that's not good, but it's just you on your own. You can pick yourself up, and there's not as much at stake. So I guess that's, take big risks, don't give up. Like I said, it's the self-help cliches, but
thank you very much, sir.
Left with. Thank you.
Hi, Matt. My name is Mackenzie. I am a communications major with a focus in broadcast media. And my question to you, 2 weeks ago, I had my first day of my law and communications class, and we walked in, and we actually discussed the controversy surrounding your appearance here on this campus. And we actually discussed this petition that was spread around the university with 600 signatures of students and faculty asking the university to prohibit you from coming and speaking on this campus on the basis that it violated their inclusion policy. And then the professor talked about the legality of something like that and asked us if we believed there was any value in you coming to speak here today. So my question to you is, do you believe there's any person in this country whose presence or words carry such little value that the university should effectively ban them from coming and appearing on this campus?
No, but that's one way of looking at it. I like to take it in a more flattering way, that I'm such an imposing figure that just by speaking words, I can reap a devastation upon countless people. No, listen, I wasn't aware of that petition. I wish I had known about it. I would have made fun of it on my show. I could still make fun of it. It's never too late. The only quick thing I want to say about that is that, yes, that's an example of a university not being open to dialogue, being hostile to free speech. All of that is anathema to what education is supposed to be, especially a place of supposed higher education. It's supposed to be a place where we can talk about ideas and And if you're encountering an idea you disagree with, then it's good to encounter that. Iron sharpens iron, and you learn something about your own worldview when you encounter someone who disagrees with it. So all that's true. It's a free speech issue. But I also always want to emphasize that when the universities ban or try to ban a conservative from speaking on campus, especially one who just wants to talk about basic biological facts, it's not primarily an attack on free speech. It's primarily an attack on truth. So what makes it so insidious and ridiculous to try to stop me from speaking is not just that I have my own point of view and my opinions I want to share and I should be allowed to share them. Yeah, that's true. But it's that what I'm going to say is obviously true. And so you're trying to stop people from not just speaking, but from speaking the truth. And I think there should be open dialogue on a college campus, obviously. But before that, there should be truth on a college campus. And the fact that they're trying to shut that down is, to me, the most deranged part of it.
Thank you.
It is hot in here. It's not just me, right?
Yeah, it's hot in here. Okay. So my question, I got a little long one. It's from Brian Kaplan. He's a professor. He wrote this as a response, as a definition of women to your documentary. Literally, a woman is an adult human female. But to be nice, we extend honorary woman status to biological males with strong gender dysphoria. While this initially seems odd, we're just treating the word woman the same way we've long treated the word parent. Literally, a parent is a human who is sexually reproduced. But to be nice, we extend honorary parent status to people who adopt kids. Strictly speaking, they're not real parents, but it's rude to say so, and even ruder to make a big deal out of it. He later goes on to clarify that there are clear societal benefits to calling people who adopt kids parents, while the societal impact for calling men women seems potentially harmful. Do you think his analogy to adoptive parents is fair? And if not, how is his analogy flawed, excluding the societal benefit aspect?
So he's acknowledging that there's no societal benefit, or even it's societally harmful to say that trans women are women. He's acknowledging that?
He acknowledges that it seems like there seems to be some societal harm, and I think you go further and describe some of that societal harm.
And he's also acknowledging that they're not really women, we're just saying they are.
I don't want to misquote him, but yes, he's saying that they're really not women, but we use the term as an honorary term for men with severe gender dysphoria.
Okay. So I just want to establish that. So we're talking about, so we don't agree fundamentally on the truth of the situation. This now we're getting into like etiquette. What's the polite thing to do? I think that it's never the polite and kind and right thing to do to lie to someone and to affirm them in delusion, especially ones that are self-destructive and breed despair, like we talked about. Now, as to his analogy, it's an interesting analogy. In fact, it's interesting that that's probably the most interesting point I've heard from anyone attempting to justify trans women are women, and it's coming from someone who doesn't even buy it. So that's kind of interesting that no one on the left ever thought of that. But I still think that it's flawed. I think in the end it's a flawed analogy. And the main reason is that when we talk about parent, we're describing a relationship. Parent is a description of a relationship, whereas woman is a description of an individual. It's a biological description in and of itself. Whereas parent, we're describing the relationship between an adult and a child. And so I think when you're describing a relationship, you have a little bit more room to take someone who is not a biological parent and still refer to them as a parent. So I guess that's the crucial distinction for me.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
All right, so this will be our last question of the Q&A session.
Make it good.
Good evening, Mr. Walsh. My name is Reagan Woody, and I'm a student at Sweetbriar College, and I'm a pre-K school teacher major. And as we see this ideology is being brought into our classrooms, for example, on my first couple days of classes, I was asked what my pronouns are. In high school, we had to fill out a form in one class asking what our preferred name and pronouns were and if we wanted it to be hidden from our parents, and drag queen story hours are becoming popular. How do we fight this and keep it out of our classrooms? It's prominent in our schools, and it's interrupting our curriculum and taking away from what students actually need to be learning.
And sorry, what kind of school was this in?
So, high school, it was really bad. College, it's still really bad. And as we see, like, drag queen story hours and stuff is becoming popular in elementary schools.
Yeah. I think, the first thing that we do in fighting against these things is the most basic thing, which is just to simply speak out against it. And you know, I guess we often think that, well, just by saying something, by protesting it, that's not going to achieve anything. And I think conservatives for a long time assumed that, and then we saw over the last couple of years, well, now we're mobilizing a little bit more. We're speaking out against these things. We're simply like taking to the street. You know, we had a rally in Nashville, for example, just literally speaking out, saying this is wrong, and it does have a massive effect. So that's one thing that we can do. On an individual level, though, if you're in these environments, let's say you're on a college campus where this stuff is being hoisted on you, the first thing I always tell people is that, you know, if you're at your job, if you're on a college, if you're at school, I don't think you're called morally to go jump on every grenade that you find. You don't have to go out looking for confrontation if you don't want to. If you want to, that's great. That's kind of how I am, and we can be, we have that in common. But I don't think everyone is called to do that necessarily. And also, when you're going to school, it's like you do want to. You're paying a lot of money. You want to get the education. You want to get the degree. You're at a job. You know, you don't. You want to try to get the paycheck. You're taking care of a family, and so that's something you have to weigh as well. And so I think. You are standing in the truth yourself. You're representing the truth. You're not going to compromise on that. Doesn't mean you're going out of your way to look for confrontation. You're not running up to someone who identifies as a woman and like screaming in their face, you're really a man. Again, if you want to do that, go ahead. But I don't think you're necessarily called to. I think when push comes to shove, it's when you're kind of backed into a corner, really. And it's like you either have to affirm this or not. And in those situations, when it's affirm it or not, then you don't affirm and you take whatever comes. You take whatever penalty comes from that, you know, because we are called ultimately to stand for truth.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.